All right, good morning and welcome to the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Aishwarya Kapoor with you. Well, first, a Global Investor Summit in Assam is our top focus this Saturday morning. All the updates on that big story and much more in the next 30 minutes in the bulletin. Let us start with the headlines. Assam gears up for the first Global Investors Summit. Prime Minister Narendra Modi to inaugurate the two-day Advantage Assam Summit in Guwahati, to be attended by 20 countries including the US, Israel, Germany, Japan and Indonesia. Game-changing scheme to provide a 5 lakh rupees health insurance cover per year to 10 crore poor families, to be rolled out by Independence Day or Mahatma Gandhi's birth anniversary this year. Niti Aayog says more funds will be made available as needed after the initial allocation of 2,000 crore rupees in the next financial year. Last date for withdrawal of candidature today for Tripura Assembly polls on 18th of this month. 307 nominations out of 320 found valid. BJP releases first list of 45 candidates for Meghalaya Assembly polls to be held on 27th of this month. Three army men killed in avalanche in Machil sector of Jammu and Kashmir, one injured. Soldiers were buried in snow after avalanche hit their posts along the line of control on Friday evening. And Australia lose early wickets after winning the toss and choosing to bat first against India in the ICC Under-19 World Cup final. They are 3 wickets down for 90 runs. India unbeaten in the tournament so far and eyeing for a record 4th cup win. Our top story this morning, Prime Minister Narendra Modi will inaugurate the first Global Investor Summit in Guwahati today. The Assam government's mega investment exposition will be attended by the captains of Indian industry, besides representatives from 20 other countries. Now, the aim of the summit is to showcase Assam's investment potential and highlight its geostrategic advantage as India's expressway to ASEAN countries. The maiden Global Investors Summit 2018 Advantage Assam, which aims to project Assam as India's expressway to the Southeast Asian nations, will be inaugurated by Prime Minister Narendra Modi today. The two-day summit will witness the presence of over 2,000 domestic and international industry leaders and representatives. The Assam government is offering 160 square kilometer industrial corridor to facilitate easy land purchases, to establish firms without land conversion issues and fresh land allotments to create brand new industrial estates.
This is a golden opportunity for the people of Assam and Northeast because the Honorable Prime Minister has given a lot of emphasis for the speedy growth of the entire region. So this is a greatest advantage for all of us.
Assam's 12 focus areas where it is seeking big ticket investments are handloom, textiles and handicrafts, bamboo, agriculture and food processing, pharmaceuticals and medical equipment, plastics and petrochemicals, IT and ITs, tourism, hospitality and wellness, power, inland water transport, civil aviation, petroleum and natural gas, startup innovations, and heavy industries. This will be the largest ever investment promotion and facilitation initiative by the government of Assam. This is Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV. And Prime Minister Narendra Modi congratulated the Assam government for promoting the state in a big way by organizing the Global Investment Summit. In a series of tweets, he said that the Advantage Assam Summit will focus on vital sectors of Assam, and the summit will also contribute towards fulfilling the aspiration of Assam's youth. More news from Assam. Bhutan has become the second country after Bangladesh to open a consulate in Guwahati. The Bhutanese consulate office was jointly inaugurated by Assam Chief Minister Sarbanand Sonowal and Bhutanese Foreign Affairs Minister Leongpo Dangcho Dorji on Friday. Bhutanese Prime Minister Sherin Togbe was also present on the occasion. The Bhutanese Prime Minister is in India to attend the two-day Global Investors Summit from today. Top Gear says that Bhutan would organize several programs in India to celebrate the 50 years of friendship between the two countries. Bhutan has had a consulate in Kolkata for years besides a high commission in New Delhi. Now, following the inauguration, Chief Minister Sarbanand Sonowal tweeted, "Privileged to jointly inaugurate a Royal Bhutanese Consulate General with Foreign Minister of Bhutan, commemorating 50 years of former diplomatic relations between the two neighbouring nations." He further said, "India and Bhutan share exemplary bilateral relations. Our historical and cultural linkages makes us natural friends and partners. We are sure that the Consulate General in Guwahati will further strengthen our cooperation in trade, tourism, education and cultural interactions." His tweet was retweeted by Prime Minister of Bhutan, Togpe. And with the 25 mantras, advice to parents and teachers and a set of useful yoga asanas, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has done what perhaps no other head of a country has ever done. Prepare students to face examinations without the accompanying stress. The book Exam Warriors, written by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and published by Penguin Random House, will be released today. The book will be released by External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj in the presence of Prime Minister. Now, dedicated to the youth of New India, the book is integrated with the Narendra Modi mobile app. On to some other news now. Policy think tank Niti Aayog said that government's top focus in the budget 2018-19 has been on the social sector. Niti Aayog CEO Amitabh Kant said that achieving a 10% growth rate is not possible without giving priority to education, health and agriculture sectors. He said that the health protection scheme has been given a careful thought. Let's take a listen.
हमारी नीति आयोग में हमेशा हम लोग को की बिलीव रही है कि अगर देश को 9-10% से ग्रो करना है अगले 30 वर्षों तक तो ये बिना हेल्थ और एजुकेशन के और एग्रीकल्चर के बिना ये पॉसिबल नहीं है और हेल्थ और एजुकेशन पर बहुत फोकस ज़रूरी है तो इस बजट ने उस पर सेंटर स्टेज लाया कई मेजर रेवोल्यूशनरी चीज़ वो लाए इस बजट में एक तो हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस जिसके बारे में बात करेंगे और प्राइमरी हेल्थ सेंटर्स 1.5 लाख जिसमें हम प्राइमरी हेल्थ पर पूरा फोकस करेंगे और तीसरा कि 24 डिस्ट्रिक्ट हॉस्पिटल्स जो कि मेडिकल कॉलेज में कन्वर्ट करेंगे और जब इसको आप टीबी का जो 500 रुपए का नेशनल न्यूट्रिशन कंटेंट को अप्रूव किया उन्होंने कल के बजट में और उसके साथ पहले नेशनल न्यूट्रिशन मिशन को अप्रूव किया गया था और ये सब को जब आप देखते हैं कि इंस्टीट्यूशनल रीस्ट्रक्चरिंग हो रही है.
And Health Minister J.P. Nadda has also allayed concerns about the funding of the National Health Protection Scheme. Well, the government's ambitious National Health Protection Scheme to provide 10 crore poor families health insurance cover of 5 lakh rupees per year is seen as a game changer in the healthcare sector. Now, speaking to Rajya Sabha Television, a member of Health Niti Aayog, Dr. Vinod Paul said that an allocation of 2,000 crore rupees for the scheme in 2018-19 has been made, but more funds will be made available as the program is rolled out over the years. Dr. Paul also said that the program would be rolled out latest by Mahatma Gandhi's anniversary this year.
Government has announced world's largest healthcare program in the budget, and joining me right now is member Health Niti Aayog, Dr. Vinod Paul. Welcome to Rajya Sabha Television, sir. Government has announced that there would be insurance cover of 5 lakh rupees for 10 crore families. What would be the financial implications? Where will the funding come from and how much funding would be required?
The financial implications of the full range of scheme we estimate to about 10 to 12,000 crore at the time of full maturation. Since it is a centrally sponsored scheme, there is a share of the state governments to also be a part of this total requirement, typically in the ratio of 60 for the union government and 40% for the state, but there are states where the union government contribution is as much as 90%. However, in the first year, we will take a few months to launch it. Hopefully, it will be launched very, very soon, but latest by 2nd October 2018. Because this lag period, the scheme is really not rolling out, so there'll be less budget required. Plus, when the states will gradually pick up this scheme, some states will come right away. Maybe six states will be, you know, right away they'll take it up. Others will join later, and 20th state would join maybe, you know, 9 months from now. Therefore, initially the requirement would be relatively small. It'll pick up, and it'll pick up very fast eventually. Therefore, a provision of 2,000 crore has been made. We feel that we should be able to provide coverage to half of the potential beneficiaries.
How much would be the monthly premium?
There is no premium on the part of the family. What you can say, what is expected to be contribution per family that has to go into this assurance mechanism? To us, it seems that will be in the range of 1,000 to 1,200. All citizens of India, from the newborn, from antenatal care, and care at birth, you know, hospitalizations related to pregnancy, that's before birth, up to all ages will be covered.
Thank you so much for talking to us. From Delhi, with camera person Kavaljeet, I'm Kriti Mishra for Rajya Sabha Television.
And Health Minister J.P. Nadda on Friday sought to allay concerns about the funding of the National Health Protection Scheme announced in the Union Budget this year. The minister assured that finances will never be a problem and said that the centre was working out on the nitty-gritties of the programme.
आयुष्मान भारत के तहत हेल्थ के सारे कंपोनेंट्स को कवर किया गया है और हेल्थ के सारे कंपोनेंट्स में सारे स्टेजेस को भी कवर किया गया है कॉम्प्रिहेंसिवली एड्रेस किया गया है इट हैज एड्रेस द प्राइमरी हेल्थ केयर इट हैज एड्रेस द सेकेंडरी हेल्थ केयर एंड इट हैज ऑल्सो एड्रेस्ड The tertiary health care, बहुत से components को हमने जोड़ा है और हमने इसको wellness center के रूप में बनाया है और ये लगभग 1.5 लाख 1.5 लाख centers हैं ऐसे जिनको हमको wellness center में convert करना है
And Minister of State for Finance, Shiv Pratap Shukla, has allayed the apprehensions of NDA constituents and the Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh on the budget, saying that the government has paid heed to the interests of all sections of the society. Shukla also said that this budget would pave the way for the creation of a new India. Our correspondent Kriti Mishra spoke to Shiv Pratap Shukla. Let's take a listen.
Joining me is MOS Finance, Mr. S.P. Shukla. Sir, the budget primarily focused on the social infrastructure and also for the development of farmers in the country. But a lot of NDA constituents have expressed their displeasure on the budget.
किसी पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक पर कह रहे होंगे कि जैसे टीडीपी कहता है कि हमारे राज्य को इतनी आवश्यकता थी कि उसको नहीं दिया गया तो ऐसे सब पॉइंट्स को जब हम कमेटी में डिस्कशन करेंगे तो किसी किसी का आएगा तो बजट के बाद हमेशा सुधारात्मक स्थिति रहती ही है किसी की कोई कमी रह जाए तो उसको हम लोग स्वीकारते रहे तो उसमें कोई बात आ गई तो शेष सारे बजट को वो सभी लोग भी स्वीकार कर रहे हैं
सर भारतीय मजदूर संघ दे हैव आल्सो रेज्ड सेवरल प्रोटेस्ट
Maybe, लेकिन I feel एक सर्टेन पॉइंट्स पर वो भी अपना कर रहे होंगे
सो डू यू थिंक दिस बजट वुड अशर इन द एरा ऑफ न्यू इंडिया
श्योर श्योर मैं ये मतलब न्यू इंडिया को पूरी तौर पर यह बजट परिभाषित कर रहा है और मुझे लगता है कि अभी जो दावोस में प्रधानमंत्री ने सबको दावत देकर के आया है कि इंडिया चलो और न्यू इंडिया बनाने में तुम भी मेरे सहयोगी हो सकोगे वहाँ टैक्स दो और लोगों को रोजगार दो लोग उससे जुटेंगे इस देश के लोग रोजगार भी पाएंगे और वह लोग भी इस देश को टैक्स देकर के तब अपना मुनाफा ले जाएंगे
थैंक यू सो मच फॉर टॉकिंग टू अस फ्रॉम दिल्ली विद कैमरा पर्सन सुरेश आई एम कृति मिश्रा फॉर राज्यसभा टेलीविजन
And Railways Minister Piyush Goyal clarified on Friday that Indian Railways is not running on losses. Goyal informed the Rajya Sabha during question hour that the government is constantly improving the efficiency of the Indian Railways. He also said that the railways will review flexi pricing for dynamic pricing without hiking the fares of the trains.
During question hour in Rajya Sabha, Railways Minister Piyush Goyal sought to allay apprehensions of members on the revenues of Indian Railways. Responding to supplementaries raised by Harshvardhan Singh Dungarpur, the minister asserted that for the last 4 years, rail fare has not been hiked and Railways is constantly improving its financial position by offering better services.
The Railways is not in losses, certainly because we have not increased the fares for about 4 years now, after 2014-15 budget. In the last 4 years, there have been no increase in fares, either on passenger or on freight. Therefore, certainly there has been a stress on the budget of the railways, on the expenditure of the railways, more so with the implementation of the pay commission, which incurred an additional expenditure of about 15,000 crores. Plus about 2,000-3,000 crores in the current year because of the allowances at the 7th Pay Commission, and the impact on pensions of 7,000 crores. The Railways has in fact added an additional expenditure of 24,000 to 25,000 crores.
Goyal also said that a complete revamp of the flexi fare scheme is on the anvil. Just like airlines and hotels, Railways could soon be dishing out discounts on tickets if trains are not fully booked.
Got a report from a very high-powered committee where we had also included representatives of the airline industry and the hotel industry to get a feel of what could be a more dynamically profitable way to set the fares, so that during the off-season we could possibly even give discounts to attract more traffic, and the fares would self-adjust themselves through technology, through artificial intelligence or algorithms to make rails have more occupancy and improve our revenues.
Goyal also said that Railways has a 100-year-old signalling system and the government will soon set up a new one. With this change, the carrying capacity of Railways will also be doubled.
Railways Minister Piyush Goyal also clarified that Indian Railways carries out certain transportation activities that are uneconomic in nature. However, these activities are for larger interests of society. Losses incurred on this account are termed as social service obligation on Indian Railways. Reporting from Parliament House Complex, with counterperson Dushmanta, I'm Kriti Mishra for Rajya Sabha Television.
Big story coming in from Jammu and Kashmir, where 3 soldiers were killed and another one was injured after an army post came under a snow avalanche in a Machil sector of North Kashmir's Kupwara district on Friday evening. The army post along the line of control came under avalanche, burying the 4 men. A search operation by snow avalanche rescue unit was initiated immediately and all the 4 soldiers that trapped under snow were evacuated. However, one lost his life on the spot and 2 others succumbed to their injuries while being referred to the army hospital. The 4th one is said to be stable and is recuperating in the hospital. All the election news now. In Tripura, today is the last day of the withdrawal of candidature for the upcoming state assembly polls to be held on the 18th of this month. 320 nominations from different political parties and independent candidates have been filed. Out of these, 307 candidates were found valid after scrutiny that was held on 1st of February. Voting for the 60-member assembly has been slated for 18th of February and the counting of votes is slated for 3rd of March. The term of the state assembly is ending on 14th of March. And the BJP has released its first list of candidates for the upcoming assembly elections in Meghalaya. The list containing 45 names was finalized by BJP's Central Election Committee. The last day for the filing of nominations for the state polls is the 7th of February and the date of scrutiny of nominations is 8th of February. And the last date for the withdrawal of candidates is 12th of February. Polling for the 60 seats assembly poll will be held on 27th of this month and the results will be declared on 3rd of March. Big story coming in from Nagaland, where 3 MLAs of the Naga People's Front resigned from the membership of the state assembly and also the party ahead of the assembly elections there on 27th of February. According to a notification issued by the Nagaland Assembly, NPF MLAs Dr. Long Rin Ken, L. Kemo Kani Ungan and Pukhai Sumi have resigned from the house. The 3 were also parliamentary secretaries in the NPF government led by T. R. Zeliang. On to some other news. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu attended the Medhuram Festival in Telangana on Friday. It was the first time that a constitutional authority was attending the biggest tribal festival in India. On the occasion, the Vice President appreciated that the people of Telangana were continuing such great traditions.
Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu visited Medhuram on Friday afternoon and offered prayers to tribal goddesses Samma Akka and Saralamma in Bhupalapalli district in Telangana. The Vice President is the first top constitutional authority to attend the festival. Vice President Naidu offered the traditional offering of jaggery to the goddesses and prayed for the welfare of all.
I feel privileged and also fortunate to come over here to this Medhuram Jatara, which is the largest Adivasi tribal congregation, to my knowledge, even in the world. This is the tradition of the Adivasis, who are the original inhabitants of our ancient land.
The Medhuram Jatara or festival is celebrated to pay tributes to the warriors of the Koya tribe, Samma Akka and her daughter Saralamma, who fought against the unjust laws of the Kakatiya rulers. Over 1 crore people from Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh attend the festival that attracts huge crowds from non-tribal communities. Rajkamal Rao's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
An External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj on Friday wrapped up her 2-day goodwill visit to Nepal, during which India assured support to Nepal in its efforts to attain political stability and development. On Friday, Sushma Swaraj met CPN Maoist Centre Chairman Pushpa Kamal Dehal, now an ally of Nepal's Prime Minister in waiting, KP Sharma Oli. Sushma and Prachand discussed measures to strengthen bilateral relations. Sushma and CPN UML chairperson Oli also discussed ways to take the special relationship between India and Nepal forward. Swaraj assured the country's top leadership that India is looking forward to working with Nepal's democratically elected government to take bilateral ties to newer heights. Swaraj also called on President Bidya Devi Bhandari. She also held a meeting with Nepal's outgoing Prime Minister Sher Bahadur Dweba. And during the meeting, she congratulated Dweba for conducting elections in Nepal successfully. She also met with Nepal's former foreign minister, Upendra Yadav. It is noteworthy that MEA has been given 650 crore rupees for projects in Nepal in this year's union budget, which is almost 75% more than what was allocated to the country in 2017-18. And reacting to the ongoing political turmoil in Maldives, India on Friday said that Maldives government should respect and abide by the order of its Supreme Court. India also added that while it is closely monitoring the evolving situation in Maldives, India has also asked the Maldivian government to ensure the safety of Indian expatriates living there. The Maldives Supreme Court on Thursday ordered the release of all key political prisoners, including former President Mohamed Nasheed. In a statement, External Affairs Ministry spokesperson Ravish Kumar said that as a close and friendly neighbor, India wishes to see a stable, peaceful and prosperous Maldives. We also hope that the safety and security of the Indian expatriates in Maldives will be ensured by the Maldivian authorities, unquote. On the sporting action now, and the final match of the ICC Under-19 World Cup between India and Australia is underway at New Zealand's Tauranga. The hosts are at 132 for 3 wickets, with the batsmen Jonathan Mirko and Paranupal at the crease. And both the teams are aiming to win the tournament for the fourth time, with India having a slight edge, not having lost a single game in the entire tournament this time. The performances of the Indian team has been phenomenal. India had earlier beaten Australia by 100 runs in their tournament opener. India also beat Pakistan by 203 runs. Now, Australia against India in the tournament came in 1988 and 1998. Australia, that is a beauty. It's just come. News from the world of badminton. A top-seeded Indian shuttler PV Sindhu has advanced into the semi-finals at the Indian Open Badminton Tournament going on in New Delhi. While number 4 PV Sindhu beat Beatriz Corrales of Spain 21-12, 19-21, 21-11 in the quarterfinals of the women's singles. Sindhu will next take on a third seed, Ratchanok Intanon. Meanwhile, Saina Nehwal crashed out of the tournament after losing to Ben Wen Xiang of the United States 10-21, 13-21. In the men's singles, B. Sai Praneeth and Sameer Verma have also exited the tournament. Speaking about the mixed doubles, Pranav Jerry Chopra and N. Sikki Reddy have advanced to the semi-finals, defeating the Chinese pair of Han Chang Kai and Cao Tong Wei 21-8, 21-13. And that's it from the entire breakfast news team at the moment. But news and updates continue on Rajya Sabha Television. Thanks for your time.